And often that leads to a pervasive sense that I'm a half-empty glass at best. I'll never really amount to anything. And I remember as a young child hearing those words from my hero, my own father, in a time of his anger and dysfunction and difficulties in his life. He made statements that I'm never going to amount to anything. Well, part of me took that on board. It must be true because he's my father and he knows me better than anybody. Fortunately for me, there was a part of my personality, and later through other healthier relationships, I began to realize, wait a minute, you know, he was having a bad day, and just because he said it doesn't mean it's true. And God, by his grace, helped me to overcome some of those thoughts and beliefs about myself. But not everybody is so fortunate or so blessed. It's a real struggle sometimes. They look in the mirror and what they see is not pleasant. Now the reaction to that is to, in many ways, try and become something that they don't feel that they are. They try and compensate for it in many different ways, or they try and cover it or anesthetize it through substance abuse. Again, more on that as we move forward. Often that we'll see one of the indicators that someone may have been maltreated or is involved in that is a lack of intimacy. They just don't know how to express themselves in a healthy adult manner. And that's, again, it's not always something that you learn about right up front, but eventually you'll find that often, both in communication, but also in their intimacy, their sex life, etc., that there's just a great deal of disconnect with one another. And it's a part of this whole scenario of having been abused or neglected. Along with it is often a sense of helplessness, hopelessness. I can't stop, I can't get out of it, I can't change, I can't. There's that feeling that you get when you listen to them of a continuous yes, but. Yes, I know I need to do something, but I can't. Yes, I know I need to change. I can't. Yes, I know I need to look for someone that's healthier in relation. I can't. And that learned helplessness is insidious. Again, we'll talk more about that because it's part of the cycle that's in many ways the most difficult part to break. Because as adults, we are not helpless. We are not what we were as a child. We have choices. Choice requires courage. It requires faith. And it's not always easy. And much of counseling, especially domestic violence counseling, is kind of coming alongside of a person and lending them your faith. I know that you don't think you can ever change, that you can't fix this situation, but I've walked this journey before, and I know you can. You can learn to make good and healthy choices. But that's one of the biggest obstacles to overcome. Often we find also just unresolved feelings of anxiety and depression and grief and loss. You see a repetition of the abusive patterns. I mean, my own grandmother on my mother's side, I mean, she was married. Well, her last husband's name was Bud. But we called him Henry, for Henry VIII. And in virtually every relationship that she had, they all ended up in divorce. But most of the time, she was the perpetrator of abuse within the relationship. And it became this incredibly horrible, destructive cycle. She could never accept any responsibility for her own actions, nor was she willing to seek the help necessary to change. Well, often again, then we see post-traumatic stress symptoms, if you will, flashbacks, rage, etc., that are a part of what happens when someone has been traumatized, especially as a child, but also within a marriage relationship. Because, you know, in marriage, you assume it's a place of safety. Children assume that their parents truly love them. Love them to an extent that they will provide whatever it is that they need in order to be successful in life. And when it turns out that the place that I live, the relationship that I'm in, is not safe, it is extremely painful. And the result of that is often introjection of the emotion or the pain. They swallow or they ingest the I am not good enough and I am never going to make it and life is horrible and nobody's going to hurt me like that again, which tends to then become a reaction when, again, stress or triggers happen in a person's life. So as you're assessing and you're listening to stories and you're connecting with people who are involved in this, you're going to listen for a few things, especially for jealousy, and you're looking for controlling behavior. You want to make sure that people recognize or learn what their triggers are, and you want to help them, especially with what we call unrealistic expectations within relationship. I mean, there are people that really do expect that we should think exactly alike as a man and a woman. Talk about unrealistic expectation. I mean, men and women are quite different, thank God. And they think differently about different things. They look at things in different ways, and that's one of the joys of life, is learning about those differences. But in fact, for many, the expectation is you should see things the way I see things. If you don't agree with me, then you're against me. And if you're against me, then I need to do something about that, because you might reject me or abandon or betray me, and so therefore I will act based upon my belief system that you are not with me, you're not on the same page with me. Unrealistic expectations can be a big part of domestic violence, because as a New Zealand speaker many years ago said to me, one of the worst things that can happen is to have a whole lot of expectation in a marriage, because the higher your expectations, the greater the likelihood of disappointment. If you don't expect much, you can go along pretty blissfully happy, and especially if you're able and willing to simply accept your spouse the way that they are. Other things that can happen as in the dynamics of a domestic violence relationship is often isolation. In other words, one partner will try and isolate the other partner from other relationships because of the fear of being exposed or discovered, or the fear that they could, you know, lose their partner. Also, you want to listen for the blame game. Often you'll find in domestic violence that the one spouse or the other, in some cases both, are continuously blaming the partner for their problems. I mean, a simple scenario would be, husband gets home from work and he has said, unrealistic expectation, dinner would be on the table at 5 o'clock. It's got to be hot, well prepared, etc., so that as soon as I walk in the door, I can sit down and eat because I'm starving to death. Now you have a woman that has 3 kids and trying to do the best that she can to just keep life together, and she's some little problem happens with one of the kids, and she's 5 minutes late putting the dinner on the table. And the husband is enraged. How could you do this to me? I work, I struggle, I do all of these things for the family. I can't believe that you would be so neglectful. You have all day to take care of the one thing that I need. And sadly, sometimes it will escalate to a point where I'm not going to eat your slop. They throw their food, the plate, across the room, and sometimes it escalates even to physical abuse. Again, a completely unrealistic expectation, but later, if you listen to the man tell the story, I mean, what do you expect? She obviously was disrespecting me. The only thing I wanted was... You think, wait a minute, men can't be that Cro-Magnon, can they? Sadly, yes, they can and often are. And of course, it's not just men toward women. Women can be just as unreasonable with their expectations. And so, it's one of the things you want to listen for, look for. because the blame game can be very powerful, and it's often based upon truly unrealistic expectations in the relationship. They will also blame their partner for their feelings. I'm angry because you said this, you did that, I punched a wall because you didn't have the dinner on the table at the right time. I acted this way because, and I feel so angry. And now, many times you'll hear the perpetrator say, I feel so hurt that you made me hit you. Really? Made you? But that's how they perceive the world. That's very immature. If you kind of close your eyes and you listen to the conversation a little bit, you say, man, that sounds about 4, 5, 6 years old. Yeah, that's about right. That's a level often of emotional maturity that you're dealing with. Now, the good thing is you can help them grow up. You can help them mature. That's part of the counseling process, both individual and group, and often comes through the dynamic process of teaching, training, equipping, especially in domestic violence courses that are offered often through churches or can be offered through the state, etc. Other things that you'll see is hypersensitivity. I mean, they are just so sensitive to any offense. Now, I've had a dear friend of mine say, you know, if you can be offended, you will be offended. Well, that's true. And offense comes. And it's, you know, you're not always expecting some sort of criticism, but even the slightest criticism can be seen as an assault to the person that's victimizing another. The hypersensitivity is something that you listen for, you look for, along with the jealousy and the isolation and the blaming, etc. They're often a part of this whole difficult, painful dance called domestic violence. Now, again, as you get to know some of the history of violent perpetrators, is often you find that it didn't start in marriage. That it started often as children, in cruelty to other children or cruelty to animals. Playful use of force in sex, quote unquote playful. Verbal abuse, which they were either raised with and or perpetrated. In other words, we know that oftentimes, like a snowball, it gets bigger as it goes downhill. And, you know, stuff runs downhill. So it starts with dad yelling at mom, who yells at the eldest sister, who yells at the middle brother, who yells at his little brother, who kicks the dog, who bites the cat and eats the mouse. I mean, it's just rolling downhill with this rage and verbal abuse. And many times you'll see that they've been raised in family system with very rigid roles and rigid role expectations of the way a woman is supposed to be, the way a man is supposed to be. And often, especially nowadays, those stereotypes don't really hold to be true. But if they've been raised in that kind of stereotypical type of family system, it's a precursor to the potential for acting out behavior. And often, you know, what you'll see as you're working with individuals, as you're working with families, kind of a Jekyll and Hyde kind of individual. I mean, oftentimes you'll find that a person who has perpetuated domestic violence is, in many ways, one of the nicest people you've ever met. They present very differently from who they are when they're in the middle of rage and acting out that rage. And so you have to kind of get beyond the facade, if you will. Often you'll find that there's been some sort of past battering or violent threats, breaking of objects, you know, force in argument, often that leads up toward the actual event of abuse, which is the thing that eventually gets public or reported. And so as you're working with people, as you're listening to their stories, you want to be aware of the symptoms. You want to be aware of the things to look for that would indicate perhaps the level of dysfunction within the relationship. Now, again, if you're called into a counseling situation where domestic violence is already, it's already clear, it's already happened. It may be the first cycle, second cycle, who knows? But you're now being called in to try and help. You have to be aware of the level of problem that you're dealing with and the types of repercussions that happen because someone has been abused. The first thing, the first repercussion of abuse, neglect, abandonment, betrayal is a sense of powerlessness. And essentially, the statement of the victim is, I have no power. They often have, therefore, severe doubt and a sense of despair, a deadness inside. I just don't feel life. I don't feel happy. I don't feel sad. I just exist. I'm in this basic malaise. And, you know, they have almost a loss of self. I don't know who I am separate from the person that I'm in relationship with. I don't have my own life. I have his life. I have her life. And I live my life according to their dictates because, as I said, I have no power. They often, therefore, will have inadequate adult judgment. Things that would seem to make sense that, of course, you know what to do in this situation or that, they can't make a decision. Their judgment has been impaired because, again, their power has been taken away from them. And thus, they're often unable to care for themselves or care for and properly protect those under their care. Now, again, it's not always true in a sexual abuse, especially an incest situation within a family, that the mom knew nothing about it and was denying that. I mean, the fact is, many times, the dads are so slick and the kids are so traumatized and fearful of sharing that the mother doesn't know. But in most cases, there's some sense of knowledge that things aren't going well within the relationship. And many times, people who have been involved in abuse as children, when it comes time for their own parenting and care for their children, they just can't see things. They don't see things that are going on because, again, I can't do anything about it anyway. I'm powerless. A second, along with that, there's a numbing of the self that makes awareness of danger to the self and others almost impossible. So they, you know, we use this term, they almost walk into a punch. Like they know that the argument that's happening is going to result in abuse, and they almost, it's not want, but the lack of a better word, they almost want the abuse to get the anxiety, get the conflict over with. And so, you know, one of the powerlessness senses, the only power I have is the power to give in to their power. And it's a very painful and difficult place to be in life, but it's often the result of, or the repercussion that happens in children and adults because of domestic violence or abuse. The second major repercussion is a sense of betrayal. I mean, when abuse occurs, the ability to trust is seriously violated, which creates a great sense of shame and guilt. Now, I think there is such a thing as a healthy shame of knowing that I've said something or done something to hurt somebody, and it's gone against family values that are reasonable and healthy. But many times, this level of shame is much deeper. And it's not just guilt. I mean, guilt usually is related to something that I know I have done, and therefore I should feel badly about it. But guilt and shame, I mean, the shame says, not that I've done something wrong, shame says, I am wrong. I am thoroughly flawed. The result of that, again, is often a hypervigilance, a paranoia, if you will, or suspiciousness, and again, lack of healthy intimacy and denial. The third repercussion is that of ambivalence. That's feeling two contradictory emotions at the same time, love and hate, honor and betrayal, trust and fear. They often develop distorted feelings caused when a double message is experienced. The double message is, I love you, you're the most important person in my life, and if you burn the food one more time, I'm going to beat you to a pulp. You know, it's the message that says, I love you, go play on the freeway. It's a message that says, I love you, and I'm taking sexual advantage of you because we have this special relationship and you can't tell anybody, but I love you, yet I'm hurting you. I mean, that creates incredible ambivalence. Resolving the ambivalence involves untwisting then the lies. One common one is, especially when it comes to sexual abuse, is you'll find a child, say 7-8 year old child, that's abused by a male or female, whichever it is, or by an older sibling, and they'll say, but I didn't yell, I didn't scream, and it felt good. Well, of course it felt good. The body, that aspect of the body, was made to feel good. So you have to untwist the lie that nonetheless, even though it felt good and even though you didn't cry out, they were the responsible one. They're the adult. You were the child. You were the victim, but you no longer have to be a victim. You can make new choices because you are an adult today. So resolving the ambivalence requires often some wise professional care and counsel. A group that will affirm them in their taking back some of their power and placing the responsibility for what has happened to them on the perpetrator where it belongs. And the fourth then is relational style. Those that are abused are affected in how they relate then to everybody in their world. See, the only models that they've had have been abusive or neglectful. So that's what they expect and that's what they know. So often the relational style then becomes the mask that they wear to try to do the best they can, but to just try and survive in life. So as a domestic violence counselor, you have to be open and caring. Empathy, warmth, respect, have healthy, good listening skills. We'll talk more about that, but it takes a time to develop trust with someone that has been so deeply wounded. It takes time to help them to restructure their thinking. That's cognitive restructuring, where they are able to see things more clearly and understand things from a different perspective. And there's a process that we have to go through. The process takes time, the process takes energy, and those that are involved and willing to be involved in men and women that suffer from domestic violence, really in many ways, they're champions. Because they're coming along someone that is desperate to have a healthy and happy life, and you can help them in that process.